think it's probably about all we're gonna get.
It's about
10 minutes after almost. BMC Johnson, just a little bit by myself, been in the Navy for 20 years. Did one amphib, pre-com, two destroyers in my career. Two tours of duty ashore, Transit Personnel Unit, TPU, that's what I was trying to spit out. Did 3 years there before I came here, so that was my last command to now. A lot of you don't know me because I checked in board when everybody was gearing up to go on fax, so it was sort of like a blink as you guys were leaving, but I joined up a little bit later. We're going to talk about the Amphibious Bulk Liquids Transfer System, ABALTS for short. Training objectives, brief discussion of the need to use ABALTS, discuss the requirements for ABALTS, and state the equipment of ABALTS. My references I use the Naval Beach Group Handbook, Volume 1, Joint Pub 4, TAC 01, TAC 6, JLOTS, and the ABALTS Technical Manual. And you can find that ABALTS Technical Manual actually under the Bravo Company folder and in the Tech Manual folder. All right, excuses for failure attributed to the shortness of fuel will be closely scrutinized and justly. That's from Mahan back in 1911. So that explains the importance. One of the things that we're gonna have to do, we're gonna have to do pre-deployment planning, okay? Prior to deploying ABALTS, a pre-deployment plan shall be developed and executed and provided successful ABALTS mission. So we're talking about site surveys, we're talking about water depth, terrain, things like that. Your surroundings, beach obstructions, type of beach, location, of the BIU. So that right there in itself kind of gives you an idea of what type of people that you're gonna need, okay? Off anybody, top of your head, based off of this, a group of people that we're gonna need to get this done, to get ABALTS deployed. UCT. Anybody else?
EAs?
Okay, and who actually works with the EAs? Who's controlling the EAs? Because I'm assuming you're talking about the EAs on the beach, right?
BMU,
Beachmaster Unit, okay? So they're gonna have to, as far as the pre-deployment plan, once ABALTS is decided that it needed to be used, then we're gonna have to get the UTCs out there to
check the gradient of the surf.
And the Beachmasters out there to find a site for the BIU, okay? What's the norm for the BIU, anybody know?
Norm what? How far?
Placement. Yes, sir. Placement of the BIU. What's the norm? Go ahead, sir.
250 feet
above the high water mark. That's where we want to put it. Okay. Planning procedures. Planning procedures used by the JLOTS commander should basically follow as shown. Okay. Receive and analyze the mission. Conduct terrain analysis, review the enemy situation, and begin collecting necessary intelligence. Develop and compare alternative courses of action. Select the best alternative. Develop and obtain approval for its concept, pre-plan, as we discussed, and publish a plan. Everybody needs to know. Okay, here's pretty much your hierarchy or your JLOTS chain of command. Okay, you have the strategic sealift command, cargo offload discharge system, your coals, offload and transfer cots, and offshore, and you can barely see that bulk fuel system, okay? Now we're gonna get into personnel requirements, which is what we deal with specifically here at FIB-CB2. ABALTS manning is gonna require for deployment a BMC, a BM1, BN2, BM2, a BM3, a seaman, a fireman, 9 seamen, and continuing on the next page, replace your coxswains for craft masters, and you'll be within INLS requirements, okay? So just for deployment, we're talking about 29 people. That's just to stream ABALTS, okay? You also got retrieval, same amount of people, operation, a few less people, 15, okay? And then maintenance, 6. And that maintenance is really gonna be mostly with maintenance of the hose reel and then the BIU personnel.
Can you go back one? So the pilots
gone, right? Because we're not doing NLs anymore?
It all depends, sir. And I'm going to get into that because if there's a way that you can actually extend ABALTs, okay, when we get into the equipment requirements. But let me just go ahead and ask, does anybody know how long the fuel system and a water system is for ABALTs? How long?
How many feet?
10,000 feet, okay.
6 inches and 4 inches.
Those are the two types of system. Okay, so there's actually a way to extend that if you can borrow a fuel system or borrow a water system from our counterpart or our sisters on the West Coast to slide a CM or a IM underneath with a pump for a point more and extend it out even further. So now you got 20,000 feet. So that's where the pilot will come into play.
Okay.
Okay, get a little bit more about requirements. We're talking about one deployment craft with crew, one salvage slash safety craft with crew, and your beach party team. That's from us, okay? That's not including the UCTs and so on and so forth. Okay, one craft would be assigned for the ABALTS OIC, that's the BMC, to assist in the installation of the ABALTS. And a tender craft is required to be assigned full-time support ABALTS operation with the MPF tanker and waterman class ships.
Does it say what kind of
It can be normally now with INLS it's a warping tug. But that's just to pass the pigtail from the buoy to the craft. You can also use the crick.
So a Zodiac that stays Zodiac with it the whole entire time.
Yes, sir.
The six-man crew stays in, the maintenance crew has to stay in the crick, or are they, where are the six?
That personnel is going to be on the MPF, sir.
They're on the MPF ship, yes, for maintenance.
Once the ABOF system is attached to the tanker, they will stay on the ship.
So who's riding up and down the hoses and making sure everything's good?
That six-man crew.
The same six-man crew that's going up and down the MPF ship?
They're going up and down the hose.
Or the tanker, I should say.
They're going up and down the hose if there's a loss in pressure for a significant amount of time. They will send their crew out and check the hose line. Once they get a report back from the BIU beach party team that they have lost pressure.
Right.
Okay, so then they will put them in the Zodiac and send them up and down the hose wheel and they look for leaks, basically.
Oh, so they don't have to be, it doesn't have to be in the water rolling.
No, sir, it's not a 24 hour, no sir.
Okay.
No, sir. They're just available for the OIC.
But it depends on the sea state, because you know, if the,
yes, sir.
If it's a sea state of two, you don't want to be in the creek.
Yes, sir. And that's why I bought the if you look back here on the dry erase board, I bought the Our Mission type poster. You can see ABALTS is actually a part of the overall mission. There may be other missions where a craft may be available to assist with different sea states. Okay, you may have an LCM out there, a Mike boat out there, Causeway Ferry, or Warping Tug. That can assist you as going up and down your hose to check for leaks.
Thanks.
Okay. Environmental limitations for deployment. Okay. You see, installation and retrieval, they have to be pretty much the same. And that's just to constitute, make sure that the hose comes back on deck and they have a chance to survey and make sure that there are no punctures, no holes, and things like that before they go back on the hose reel. Operational state and the max survival state for it while it's submerged. These temperatures that are in degrees down here, that's when you're actually pumping fuel and water through the hose reel, depending on which one you're using. And then the beach sea floor gradient, your installation and retrieval, because of course it changes with the current, so your operational max limits. And then your maximum survival limits are the last call. And this is all in the ABALTS tech manual as well.
Can you talk to what the average wavelength requirement is?
I'm sorry, ma'am?
Can you talk to where it says average wavelength and maximum energy period? Can you talk to what those two actually mean?
The average wavelength here, 39 feet, 65 feet, and 97 feet. That's
the swell?
Not really, because my experience is kind of low. But
As far as I know, it only really affects installation and retrieval, because you're going to use your LARC, as I was going to get into, you're going to use your LARC to pass the bitter end of the hose to and from the beach. So as far as the operational part, the hose, depending on the gradient, the hose can get beat up a little bit and cause your leaks, cause your loss in pressure. So depending on the gradient that it's sitting on may determine whether that 65 will be an effect on you passing fuel. And the same thing in the survival. It's going to depend on the gradient.
So what would you say are like the three most key environmental factors for installation?
Sea state for the crew and the craft. Wind, because I experienced that, your maximum wind gust. I experienced that actually trying to deploy A-glass over in the mud flats. And current for your craft, trying to keep it a straight line. You want to keep it as straight as possible and keep it in that survey area, that buffer zone, plus or minus three that they lay down for you, UCTs. So those would be my three.
Plus or minus three what?
Degrees on either side.
3 degrees, wow, okay.
Okay, your system, we're going to start getting into components. There's three hose reels. Can anybody tell me why?
Backup.
Two for fuel, one for water.
Okay, your fuel hose reels, 5,000 feet on each reel. Okay, so that's very important, so keep that in mind. You got your diesel hydraulic power unit, your reel level wiring, okay, for retrieval purposes and put the hose back onto the hose reel as level as possible. Your control system and lighting package. 2 20-foot ISO containers of auxiliary equipment.
One per system, one for fuel, one for water.
Okay, your beach interface units, one for fuel, one for water. And then your pig launcher, one for fuel, one for water. Okay, and then your bow chute is one, okay? That's what your bow chute looks like. Okay, you have your lighting stanchion system here and your fixed davit, okay, for deploying your anchors and retrieving your anchors. Okay, it takes three people to launch and recover an anchor. And then your rigger, which would be in two, is going to stand on this side, okay, as far as retrieving the hose and deploying the hose.
Your side view, this bow chute area right here kind of keeps everything kind of straight, and then you have a slide pretty much that leads down to the edge of the INLS system.
Are there any safety concerns with that?
Oh, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You have chain that runs through this pulley that runs all the way back to the hose reel that you utilize to deploy the anchor. Each anchor has its own individual chain for connecting to the anchor buoy, so you can identify where they are and you get ready to retrieve them. So you have one wire, and then you have chain, loose chain, and then you have three decks in. So yes, ma'am, there's a lot of inherent dangers. You can get somebody tangled up. Somebody can get a finger holding onto the wire instead of hands open, palms open onto the wire. You have one guy that stays in a harness that is effectively going to manage or organize everything up there, because the anchor can't go through the pulley. So you can only get it up, so, you know, get the anchor out of the water so high, utilizing the chain when you're retrieving. So you have to readjust your chain using your second wire, because there's an A and B wire on the hose reel. So you're going to use your A wire to bring it up as far as you can, and then you're going to have that guy attach the B wire to bring it up even more to get the anchor out of the water. And so this doesn't swing, it's fixed. So now you got people reaching out over the craft, over the water. So a lot of inherent danger as far as working around the bow chute.
So what do you mount this on? What is this going to be sitting on?
I'm going to get to that.
Okay.
He's talking about the mounting plate right here. Okay, this is a picture of the hose reel. 2 5,000 foot hose reels for your fuel. 1 10,000 foot hose reel for your water. 6 inches, 4 inches. Can't mix them. Okay, and then your ISO containers. And your mounting plates have to be mounted onto the IM so that the bow chute can be as close to the edge as possible, and that the hose reel is fixed right behind me. Here's the caveat to that, okay? When you look at the IM, okay, on your starboard side is your storage hatch,
right,
for your IM. So you gotta make sure when you get ready to mount this stuff that your storage hatch doesn't get covered. So basically, but prior to any of the ABOF system getting installed, the IM is actually gonna be turned around so that the storage hatch is free. So it's actually, if you think about it, it's actually backwards. It's not, the storage hatch won't be on the starboard side, it'll be on the port side, okay? So that's the first thing that you have to think about before, when you're getting ready to install the ABOF system. Then the mounting plates go into place. They'll be craned on board.
On the starboard side.
On the starboard side, kind of center line. So it's kind of offset a little bit, all right? Your ISO container is pretty much all the way to the port side. So after the hose reel, you have your bow chute, which is all the way to the edge. Then so many feet behind that, I want to say it's about 15, maybe 10 or 15 feet behind that on IM, you have your hose reel, and then another 10 to 15 feet behind that, you have the ISO container, okay? The ISO container is going to be latched down with wraps. So the only two, you only need two mounting plates, one for the bow chute, one for the hose reel. Then the pineapples that are fixed on the bow chute will lock the hose reel on the mounting plate will lock the bow chute and the hose reel in place and keep it steady.
Yes, sir. So don't most of the INLS that come off the MPF ships, don't they make it a plus two configuration? So this would change that. They would have to take off the VM in order to deploy.
Yes, sir. No VM at all when you're doing ABOS.
So which, if you're doing,
it's actually a PM and plus one.
It's a plus one configuration.
Yes, sir.
CF PM plus
PM and IM.
Okay. So if you're doing two ABLATs, you would just use the same one, or would you do them?
Yes, sir.
One after
in that configuration, because there's enough room on the PM, the ISO container would just go on the PM.
Okay.
But if you're saying if you're installing two separate ABLATs,
right?
That would depend on.
Because you need
the answer to that is totally
930,000 gallons a day, you need two ABLATs, right?
So it just depends on what the priority is. If you can take an additional caustic carry away from ship to shore movement,
right,
then you would do them simultaneously.
Okay.
If you can't, then you just do them separately.
And also, remember what I said earlier about the pump. So you can actually get a CM and a 4-point motor and install a pump on board, then connect another section or another port, another system, ABOF system, then you can get more throughput to get your daily requirement if it needs to be more.
The CM is coming from where?
That's part of the pre-planning.
The
most important thing about planning for ABOS is where is the tanker going?
Right.
How close can we get the tanker to the beach? Okay? Because you really want about 200, maybe 300 coming in the surf zone to the beach, to the BIU, to get all the way up to that 250 feet past the high water mark. Okay? And then you want another maybe 650 feet on the tail end to go from the water all the way up to tanker freeboard to connect to the riser. Okay, so you gotta have room on both ends. So you don't have the whole 10,000 feet to play with here.
Right.
You know, you kinda gotta gauge, and that's gonna determine placement of the BIU, which is very important, and placement of the tanker. And where can you put the tanker? And where is the tanker master comfortable with mooring at or connecting to your ABOS system?
So if you had an extra reel and you were going to put that extra hose reel on to get more distance,
right,
then the combination module would come from the RDF. So you would have to reconfigure your RDF to lose a combination mod for this.
Because there's no extra CMs laying around. And could you still do your RDF one without a CM? I've seen it without the, so a picture without the shelter, the shelter module.
Yeah. You can. So you're either your docking or your ramp mod.
Yeah.
It would just be one module up. And then you'd have to accommodate that on the track of as you drive through. Could do. It's physically possible.
Why would, my question is, why would you take a piece from the RDF? Why wouldn't you just make a plus one? Take an IM from one of the public areas. Can you use an IM?
You could do that as well. Yeah, a CM and an IM are pretty much the same.
Okay.
That again goes back to the throughput. Is it better to have all your causeway ferries together and lose a little bit of like movement space on the RDF, or to maintain RDF full functionality and lose some space on the causeway ferries?
Is there an advantage or disadvantage of using a CM or an IM, Chief? Or is that just what they're teaching is to use a CM?
The only advantage, well, actually, no. No, sir, there isn't.
No.
Hey, there's pros and cons on both sides. You're losing an asset either way it go, or you diminishing an asset either way it go.
Right.
Like
you
I said,
you have to do some crazy rigging on either one to get for the 4-point anchors. I mean, you're gonna have to jimmy rig some stuff on top of the deck. No, you just lash it down to
4-point more.
Yeah. Was there bollards on there or something? How you gonna?
You've got bits, cleats, and closure loose on all.
Enough to hold it in a 4-point more.
6 or 8 points,
if you
really
want to.
Okay. Thank you. What's up? This right here, which is a picture, very small, but it's actually, if you think about the width of it, a IM, this shear connector is very important, okay? It keeps you from allowing that hose to actually tuck down underneath or get sheared off. Basically, hence the name shear connector, sheared off by the knife edge of the IM when you're deploying and retrieving. Keeps the hose connections from getting caught coming back in. So it's just
that's
a bump.
That's at the very front.
That's at the very front. It's just a bumper.
Right.
It's a aluminum bumper for the hose. Okay. It is very important. It has to be installed first before you start bringing on your height-wise equipment. So you install your shear connector first. And it is just flexing. If you ever seen flexing before, okay, we have shims. It's got legs on both sides, and it goes right into the flexor housing. You put your shims in place, and it doesn't move, okay? And then comes the mounting plates. The mounting plates are also right down to the center point clover leaf where it's supposed to be mounted. And the diagram actually in this tech manual tells you how many feet from the edge the bow shoot should be. From there, how many feet to the hose reel, and then from there, how many feet, and we just take a piece of chalk, and we just mark it off before we go underneath the crane so they'll know where the target is, where to drop it. We wipe it down into place. Once we get all the mounts right down into place, then comes the bow shoot, then comes the hose reel, and then the containers last because, like I said, we just use regular gripes and just wipe it down.
So that plate's heavy then, huh?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not a 4-man lift.
That's good. Sure. We have that in the 20-footer.
Oh no, it doesn't fit in the ISO container. The mounting plates, the bow shoe, the shear connector, and of course the hose reels are all stored outside. We're planning on getting covers for the hose reels. We had them at one point in time, but the shear plate. The mounting plate and the bow shooter just sitting over there in the back for you. It's all aluminum, so no rust. The ISO containers are actually in our little yard right behind Bravo. Let's see. And that's about it. Okay, a couple of things that's important to you. Okay, pig. We call these pigs. Not really. An acronym, just name. There's 6 inches and there's 4 inches. Okay, and what they're utilized for is to clean the system prior to retrieval. That's the main use. You also use them to check to make sure that you didn't leave anything in
And this is just a best practice type thing to check to make sure there's no residual prior to sending in fuel. Types of fuel we can send, whatever we're using. Liquid fuel marine, JP5, you know. But you want to send that pig through because you don't want that mix. There's a contam bag normally placed on the other end of the BIU when you have to or need to switch fuel. On the retrieval side, also again, another contam bag to once the pig is pushed through for the fuel to catch any residual. So kind of behoove you not to let your customers leave prior to you retrieving AVOS, because then you're stuck with dealing with the contaminant bag on the beach.
What pushes those through?
Air.
Oh, okay.
LPE from the deck?
HP, 715 pounds of pressure. We push
the pig,
the water, and the fuel. 715 PSI from the tank.
715?
715.
Your clamps are emergency tools, okay? Say for instance you have a rupture and it's right next to a connection. Well, you want to clamp it on both sides so you can repair that area. Or if you just have a rupture right in the middle of a hole, you want to clamp it on both sides, repair that portion, okay? Cut out the damaged area, and put it back together if you don't have enough holes to extend it. Okay, so say for instance, like we're pushing through water and we only need 5,000 feet or some ungodly reason, but we only need 5,000 feet. So we only put our 5,000 feet of hose. So what's the best practice? Let's go out there and replace that section of hose. But if we had to use the entire 10,000 feet from the BIU to the end of the pig, then that we have to repair it, okay? And that's where your maintenance personnel are gonna come into play. They're gonna be trying to repair this thing from the Zodiac. Okay. Unless you have other assets in the area where you can use an IM, there was discussed to just having a warping tub pick up the affected area and have an IM slide underneath and just use the IM as the as your repair area, like you would a labor repair barge for OPDS in that nature. And that way the personnel can work for you. But if you don't have that asset, they're going to be trying to repair this hose from the Zodiac. All right, this is a very bad picture of a BIU. This is actually the fuel's BIU, because it has a 6-inch inlet, okay? You see it's just basically
a Y-gate, okay?
You have your inlet, your supply, and you have
possibly two customers, okay?
Normally it's just one, and then the other
one is used for checking for contaminants, testing the fuel, testing the water, if you're using the 4-inch BIU. But you can't have two customers. It's just if
in order to test,
you would have to test on their respective ends of whether they're getting the clean fuel or clean water.
So there's a 4-inch BIU and a 6-inch BIU?
Yes, sir. You got a 4-inch hose and a 6-inch hose.
Gotta have 4-inch BIU and a 6-inch BIU.
And both of them are the same except for the diameter?
Except for the diameter.
Exactly the same. This is your picture of your pig launcher.
And this is also kept on the
Causeway Ferry Plus One, or the PowerMod Plus One. The
PowerMod can actually push a pig through using its own high pressure system.
And that's
normally how it's done. The tanker has an installed pig launcher. So it's actually built with a pig launcher, if you want to think of it that way.
And as you can see, it's nothing more. Your outlet is here, so your
the end of your hose to the beach goes here.
This is capped off. Here's where you insert your pig. Up here is where you actually attach the hose for the air. Turn your air on. It gets behind the pig. You open up the valve. And away she goes.
So the pig launcher comes in the AWOS ISO?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
So does the BIU.
So you gotta take that out before you put the container down on the craft?
Yes, ma'am. it's a pain. I really encourage you to come down and take a look at the ISO, because it would amaze you how they pack all the stuff that you actually need for AVOX. I didn't put the chart on here, but it is in the tech manual. But there are a total of 79 anchors for this system. Two anchors per collar, all the way up to how many feet that you drop out. Okay, so 79 anchors.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
79 anchors packed into two ends of an ISO container. You got to be very, very focused on the picture. They give you diagrams on how things should lay, but you know how pictures are and how metal shifts and things like that. So you kind of get very ingenious and have a little motivation to pick up the anchors and put them in the ISO box.
So how many pig launchers do we have?
One per container.
Two total.
So we use the one on the the PM plus one to push one way, and we use the ship's own mounted pig launcher to push the other way?
No, you only push one way.
Oh, okay.
Always to the beach.
So why would you ever put it on the PM plus one then?
It comes in an ISO container.
If the ship had to get underway in a hurry.
Yeah. The ship had to drop. The ship had to.
Where would you be getting fuel from then?
But you would still have to drain the hose.
So before, if the ship just took off without doing it, you would have to do it with the PM plus one at the end of the hose where the ship was at.
Yep.
Check. I want you to know.
Good.
Yep.
If you go back one, for that Y gate, you got to take it off to get the pig out.
Yes.
Was it? There's a shutoff valve so that you could.
Shut off here. These are already closed. This little bevel right here.
Yeah.
Is where the pig is caught.
Uh-huh.
And you actually have to unbolt that.
Unbolt it. Okay.
Isn't there a sight glass there that shows?
Not for this one.
No?
You're thinking about OPDS. OPDS has a sight glass, but this one doesn't. This is just a simple Y gate.
You hope it's there.
You hope.
Yeah, that's what I was
thinking. And that's where we didn't talk about it, but that's where comms come into play. Okay. Once the system is deployed.
Okay.
The OIC is going to tell the rigger to inform the beach party team we're sending a pig. So they're going to stand away and wait for the pig. There's also a nice little chart that tells you for how many feet you laid out, how long it would take for that pig to get to the beach. It's also in this table.
I'm sure you'd probably hear it too, yeah?
No.
Maybe a little thud, go boom. Nothing?
Nothing. It won't even move. It won't budge. That's why I wanted to bring a pig. It's just a styrofoam about this long.
Oh, it's only styrofoam?
Yeah. It's a styrofoam about this long. Now, the ships with OPDS, because it's a different type of hose, they actually use like a ceramic-covered ball. It's also styrofoam, but it's covered in ceramic material to make it a little bit more rigid, so it can actually bellow out to push because the conduit is a little bit more rigid than this hose. This hose will lay flat.
Mm-hmm.
OPDS hose will not. It actually builds on itself, so that's why the tanker ship actually keep them on board. But this hose will actually go flat.
Mm-hmm. Well, the white gate's open when the pigs come. Everything's open, and then once you...
This is open, these two are closed.
So where does the fuel go that is being pushed out? It has to remain downstream.
Well, I'm sorry, sir. You're correct. It's correct. One of the two will be closed, because the other one will have your contaminant.
Discharge, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Got it.
You're absolutely correct.
And then you close it.
And then you close it, and then you disconnect and pull the pig out.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You're absolutely correct. We good with the BIU?
I am.
Mm-hmm.
How about the pig launcher?
I do have a question. At the BIU, that's the responsibility of the beach party team, right?
Yes, sir.
So it's not the rigger rigging team or the six maintainers to maintain that BIU, that's the beach party.
No, but we do install it, right?
The beach party team install it, and I got another little picture. I'm going to explain that one to you. I'm a pictures guy. Okay, this is your contaminant area for your BIU. The BIU will sit inside of this. Okay, 500 square feet is what the book says that you should, when the beach masters go out to survey an area. 500 square feet for the BIU to go into this berm and then connect to the hose.
So that will actually come out of the ISO container and go with the beach party team.
And that's all folded up?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It is foldable, collapsible, I should say. Sorry. This is the messenger for the actual hose. Okay. I don't know if anybody noticed it, but part of the requirements when you're planning is that you have to have a lark available. You're going to have a Beachmaster unit. You're going to have a lark. Okay, so the Causeway Ferry is going to come up to the surf zone. It's not going to come into the surf zone because we don't have a beach module. The lark is going to come out from the beach, take the messenger, one end of the messenger, and take it back to the beach. And then on that beach, you have a dozer that is actually going to assist you in reeling this in. Once you get it onto the beach and connect it to the anchor shackle, there is actually a connection that goes onto the end of the hose that you're going to anchor it to an actual anchor. And that's part of the beach party team's job is to, once they're deployed from the PM plus one, they're going to go to the beach with the BIU and they're going to start digging a hole. And that hole has to be at least 4x8. 4 feet wide, 8 feet deep. And you're going to put two anchors, one on either side of where the beach, BIU is going to go, okay, going towards the beach at a 90 degree angle. You got 90 feet of chain. They're going to dig that hole, they're going to put that anchor in the hole, and then they're going to fill that hole. And once that's done, there's a collar device on the end of the BIU that is used to anchor the holes while it's being deployed. They have to make sure that they have enough holes on there, and they can't get this wrong because it's right in front of the BIU, maybe, you know, 3 to 5 feet from the BIU. They're going to connect it there. You're going to back out. The PM's going to back out to deploy the hose. And as you're deploying the hose, okay, every 40 feet or so, you're going to attach an anchor and a buoy. One side of the bow chute is responsible for buoys. The bow chute with the fixed davit is responsible for anchors. So one team of seamen are going to be connecting buoys. The other team of seamen are going to be connecting anchors. And then as that collar device goes out the bow chute and into the water, then the buoy goes, then the anchor will fall. Your anchor chain is determined by your depth, 3 times the depth of the water. So depending on how deep the water is, from the surf all the way out to where you're going to anchor the pigtail, it determines how much chain you have. So they need to know that. So when that survey comes back and it says a granulate of 10 all the way out and then a deep fall off and then there's no bottom, they need to know that because they need to know how far they're gonna be able to anchor the hose before they really can't anchor the hose. They're gonna be deploying anchors, but current's gonna take it wherever it needs to go if there's no bottom. Okay? So then in that regards, would you need to really use AVOS? Is it safe to use AVOS? Probably not. So that's why I keep going back to the pre-planning conference and your planning. Very detailed.
The yellow buoy on the anchor isn't buried if it's just sitting on
it. No, it's just sitting on there so they can identify where the anchor is.
How much chain can you put on an anchor?
3 times the depth of the water. There's actually a chain locker in the ISO with, I don't know, they really don't know how much chain, but it's all connected together and you actually have to physically cut the chain and attach it to the buoy with a shackle.
Okay. All
right, here's your Zodiac. It's also in the ISO container. All folded up nice and neat in a little bag that has to be put together and aired up, pumped up. Put air in it, that type of thing, okay? But it is also found in the ISO container, along with your motor, also in the ISO container, okay? So you need an IBO
qualified coxswain orders.
All right. Here's a little preliminary picture. And the reason why I show this one is because here's how your creek is going to get deployed. This is the jib boom.
It's in the top of the ISO container. It has to be affixed to the ISO container, removed out of the top, and you affix it to the port side so you can swing your rib boat or your creek.
That's crazy.
Over the side.
This is also how we get the BIU off the IM and onto the LARC for the beach party team and the two anchors that go with it.
How heavy is the BIU?
Ooh, sir.
Just off the top of your head?
I can't tell you.
I'm trying to figure out how they're going to get it out of the LARC onto the beach.
They have to drag it. They actually take that side off,
so it's
and they have
to one person pick up.
Well, actually, about eight or nine. So you send about six, maybe eight people to the beach, and then you get your BMUs to help you.
Okay.
If they don't have a forklift on the beach, if they got a forklift on the beach, it actually has grooves underneath where they can take it off the lock that way. But other than that, it's an all-person lift, as I like to call it.
But wouldn't you just drive the LARC up onto the beach and turn
yeah,
around?
Yeah, I'm talking about trying to get it off.
You still got to get it off the log.
5 foot up off the ground is where it's sitting. It's got to get down onto the beach.
I'd rather be doing it from the beach side than from the surf side.
Okay.
Does your ISO container sit on any dunnage? Or does it just sit straight on?
Yes, sir. There's actually dunnage in the ISO that have to get out of the way in when you start taking stuff off. There's dunnage for to placement of the anchors so you're not sitting it on non-skid.
Yeah.
So you can actually put when we're talking about dunnage, we're talking about just maybe 2 inches of plywood that you're gonna put down on the deck just to protect the deck a little bit. Depending on the seas and how well you gripe it down is gonna determine whether you protect your deck or not. But
there is dunnage inside the ISO container for the anchors, and you can place dunnage underneath the ISO container prior to it being installed by the crane operator. All right. So this is what it's going to look like when we're all said and done, okay? And I got a bigger picture over there if you guys can't see this, but this is also out of the tech manual. Here you have your BIU, okay? Here's the placement of those two anchors I was talking about. 4 feet wide, 8 feet deep, okay? Surf zone here. So you got your BIU hose that connects to the first piece of conduit from the ABOS system, and then a buoy, anchor buoy, and then after you get 150 feet deep, every connection, there's an anchor and a buoy, anchor and a buoy, until you get out to where the pigtail is connected, okay, two 40 feet sections, and then your saddle lock, this buoy, this right here at the end of the pigtail, two anchors, a buoy, and then your orange dam buoy, all in the ISO container. This buoy right here with, you see that little loop right there? That is a messenger, okay? So you put your guys in your rib boat, they go out to this messenger when the tank comes along and they've set their anchor and they're ready to start distributing fuel. They're gonna go and grab this messenger and they're gonna take it over to the tanker and give it to the tanker. And then from there, the tanker will haul the rest of it on board and connect it to their riser.
They throw it up there or they go up to Jacob's ladder? That's a big ass freeboard.
Yes, sir. Sometimes they'll lower down their own messenger and they just tie it. You can just tie it off. You can lower down your own messenger from the freeboard, tie it off, then they haul it back up, and then they're going to disconnect this damn buoy and keep it on board until they're ready to disconnect from the ABOS system. Like I said, they're going to pull that up on board, connect it to the riser, and then they're going to send their own pig through, okay, testing to make sure that we're still good to go. And then they're going to talk to the fuel officer who talks to the JLOS commander and say, hey, we're ready to send fuel. And then on our end, we're ready to receive fuel. And there goes fuel. Same thing for water. They're still, even though it's just water, they're still going to send a pig through once they connect it to the tank. Just best practice. Depending on how long it takes them to get to, once this is deployed,
how long it's set out there based on current environmental and things of that nature, or sleepy seamen who didn't connect it all together. Of course, the connections are already made for this system, unlike OPDS. You have to make those connections on the LRB, but they're only checked twice, once deploying and then once retrieving. So sometimes things get loose. And because I said this hose actually runs flat, if there is no coordination between the rig captain who's sitting on the bow chute and the hose reel operator, you can stretch this hose. You can part this hose with that hose reel. So really you have three people that are involved with that evolution as far as deploying and retrieval, which is the most unsafe portion of ABOS. You have a craft master, a rig captain, and a hose reel operator. All have to work in unison to get this deployed or retrieved safely. And that's all I have.
Anybody start to
have
finish?
Sir?
Start to finish if you're just lowering it all down from the MPF ship. 6 hours?
I really, me personally, sir, I don't have any experience from that point of view.
It says about 8 hours.
The book says about 8 hours?
8 hours.
I'll go with 8 hours. I know for OPDS we have to be ready to in 10 hours. So I will go with 8 hours with this system, since how it is a collapsible hose and it's easier to manage. And you don't have to rely on the tanker to help you deploy. So this system can actually be deployed to a couple of days prior to the tanker's arrival. And then you send your rear boat personnel back out there to send them the messenger, and then they can connect it themselves and go from there.
So when you hook it up to the manifold and you're pumping fuel and the current changes, or the tides change and the ship flips, do you have to disconnect and reconnect on another side?
The ship is going, during the pumping process, is going to go into a 4-point moor.
Okay.
This, unlike OPDS, you can't allow the tanker to actually move.
Okay.
As you would be able to if you were in a 1-pump moor with a song. Okay. The tanker actually connected to the song. It can actually swivel. There's actually a swivel joint on the song to allow the tanker to swivel around. This system does not have that, so they have to be pull up close enough to be able to take as much as they need up the freeboard and up to the riser. But they have to already be in a 4-point moor. They may need assistance, and they may call on the JLOS commander for assistance for setting their anchors for their 4-point moor, and that's where you're going to need to give up some assets for warping tug and things of that nature, because we're talking about smaller tankers for this system. We're not talking about an MPF loaded tanker as you would with OPDS. So they're going to rely on you to help them set and retrieve their anchors if need be. Well, not if need be. They're going to rely on you to actually help them set their anchor and get them in that 4-point moor. And then you're going to pass them the pig to connect to the riser. So we're only talking about for ABLOTS, how long?
30 days.
30 to 90 days. Not that very long at all. So ABLOTS can actually be used while you're getting ready for OPDS, maybe, because OPDS is a 7-day window to start pumping if you're utilizing a song, the contaminant bags. So you want to make sure that the JLOS commander is on board with them sticking around until you completely clean and retrieve your ABOL system. That way they can take the decam bags with them when they go, instead of you having to actually put them on the I am and try to get rid of them, or get rid of them as best you can.
Chief, is this PowerPoint on the S drive anymore?
Yes, sir, it is. Actually, if you go into the Bravo company folder and go into the training folder, that's where this PowerPoint resides. Any more questions?
Well, I really appreciate your time.
Yeah.
MPF ship or ABLOTS on?
None of them. So you're thinking, OPDS, this system is ours.
It blesses on the L ships, the B ships, and the Williams.
L's and B's. Oh, well, there you go, see? She's absolutely right. One on the Bobo, one on the Loomis, one on the Button, and one on the Lopez. There you go, ma'am. We're learning together.
She already learned it.
The B's and the L's. Oh, so we still have two and three.
So there's three ABLOT systems, one fuel, one water each on midterm three and two on midterm two.
So that's not accurate.
That one said one and one. The Williams also has.
That's in Metron 3.
And because we made this PowerPoint before they did the whole shuffle. This is a PowerPoint in the fuse folder. And that bottom thing is from someone's practice fuse board. It's a dry erase picture. That's why it's so dark.
Hey, Bubson, can you send out those Zoom?
Yes, I will. Where should I put them instead of sending them?
Actually, this fuse folder. He's going to put out the new distribution of the.
Don't do it until after tomorrow.
I'm going to do it right
now. Any more questions?
How long does it take for, so you're on the craft or on the ship, how long does it take to get onto the plus one and then you're plus 8 hours? So from where you're going to stream ABLOTS now, get everything ready to put on the craft, what's the total time?
You're talking about from the midterm ships, right?
Right, so you got the plus one in the water. How long does it take to get everything set up on the deck?
Crane down to the deck and in place and ready to go with an experienced crew, 4 hours.
Wow.
With a less experienced crew, 6+.
And then eight.
And that's only because of the placement of the mounting brackets and remembering that IM needs to be flipped around and put it actually connected backwards.
So you're looking like 12 to 16 hours to deploy all together, so it's like two ships.
Yeah. I thought they were teaching where it was an 8-hour day shift to set up and then an 8-hour shift to deploy.
Well, from the MIPSRON side of the house, like I said, my experience is limited, but me personally, I would probably use a different crew if we were doing it that way to set up. Mm-hmm. And then take your ABOX crew to deploy. So that would be your two crews. From our side, we'll already be there from the beach. We just need to find our mark and deploy.
So you said the IM has to be turned around backwards because you're gonna put the hose reel further back so you don't cover up that storage scuttle, right?
Yes.
Okay. So that when you spin it around, you're not really flexing in.
Yes, sir. They're both the same on either side.
Even though you spin them around the same?
Yes, sir. Because your connection or your bumper is not like the PM on a stern where it's just center.
Yeah.
When you're going into the docking module.
Okay.
They're actually like this. So it's one on the port side and one on the starboard side aft. So when you flip it around, it's still the same.
Still the same. Okay.
Do you have to?
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Because you have things in the storage area that you need, gripes, life vests. So there's extra tools and things down in that storage area that you're going to want to get to, especially if you're not the crew that did the LTI and the LTI is incomplete. So you're going to want to use your own storeroom to complete tools and things like that and piece parts that you can possibly to make this system work.
And it's because the hose reel and everything is going to block the hatch?
Yes, ma'am. The mounting bracket would end up right on top of the hatch if you don't spin it. So you would not have access to that storeroom at all.
Is it really a crick or is it just a zodiac?
The crick is a combat.
The crick.
Combat craft.
Rubberized and
ready. I think I beg to differ. I think they're zodiacs because the crick is longer. And the zodiac is shorter.
So zodiac. The ABOMB's protect manual calls it a crick.
That's because you got civilians,
right?
That are.
And also the CO thinks it's a crick.
I think it's a creek. I really think it's a creek.
Combat rubber braiding craft. Just that doesn't sound like you're going to use a braiding
craft. Combat rubberized braiding craft.
But I will not do semantics. I'll just call it creek.
You can call it creek. You can call it zodiac.
Zodiac.
I'm not
crew of six.
It stands for zodiac.
Not necessarily. not a crew of six for the zodiac.
But that's what the creek says.
Yeah, that's what
with the Crick Tech Manual.
Yes.
Says it's a crew of six for combat rubberized raiding craft, but
you're probably gonna
Zodiac
get about,
is smaller, like both.
You're probably going to get about three.
It's only a crew of three with a coxswain and two seamen. Maybe you don't need an engine in there. That's a bit
missing. Well, if y'all don't have anything else. You good?
Yeah. Thank you, training your guy.
Yeah.
Chief, thank
that
you.
That was awesome.
Well, I'm sorry. Good job. Thank you.
Great job.
We want this back.
It is.
On Friday. So I'm going
to. It is. I know they're going to hit me with it.
Do you have notes?
Hit me with your phone.
Yeah. I got a bunch of stuff that you can ship them and see if I'm out.
So is the lock on that container? Is it a red lock or a blue lock?
It's a blue lock, sir.
It's a blue lock, so I got the key to that.
Grab some of those slides.
I have the keys right now.
Yeah.
I spent like 20 minutes diving in trying to grab a pee to bring up her show and tell.
Yeah.
But
couldn't find it.
Really go
okay, yeah, we inventory next Thursday, so I'll just come.
And not a.
Next Thursday?
Next Thursday. I should be able to get you the names by Friday.
Okay. Yeah, if we get everybody from each of the teams,
so it takes it.
And then when it gets reorganized, I'll tell you which of your guys stayed on it and which of your guys don't.
So stand by for what exciting training I have in store for next
week. Okay, I'm going to ask you every week. You'll send out the email.
It's a good reminder for me.
Yeah, I want to know. I want to learn something to do.
Next week I will not be here.
I got to see what.
Next week I'm going to do it by board.
Not a slide, but I can find it in the tech manual.
Well, this is a tech manual.
That's the whole tech manual?
Yeah.
Okay, the
Okay, one by one ship.
Yes. Mm-hmm.